Ethan founded Beyond Meat, which is a plant-based protein alternative. Let's just start with your vision. What is it that you really wanted to create with Beyond Meat?
So the reason I really feel so strongly about what we're doing at Beyond Meat and like to communicate about it is that, you know, I look at the solution that we're trying to provide, and I've never seen anything like this in my career, where you can focus on one thing, which for us is building protein for the center of the plate, and simultaneously solve for significant global issues. And if you look at what animal protein and livestock, the impact it has on the broader world, these really can be, we call them the four horsemen at Beyond Meat. And they can be identified as such. Human health, whether it's heart disease, diabetes, or cancer, and the relationship between those disease epidemics and the high levels of meat we're consuming, particularly red meat and processed meat, right? Those are becoming more and more well known. Look at things like climate, where livestock actually is a larger driver of greenhouse gas emissions globally than transportation. Then you look at things like natural resources, where land, water, energy use is so intensive around the sheer numbers of animals that we're keeping alive on this earth's surface to feed us. And finally, animal welfare, which when I was growing up was something that was maybe thought about a little differently in the public debate, where you had to have a pamphlet handed to you or something from PETA. But today, kids can see what's going on in the factory farms where food is being produced on their handheld phones, and they can send it to their friend very quickly. And that's creating a movement that is feeding into our brand, which is unprecedented. The access and the transparency, whether the industry wants it or not, that's occurring as a result of technology. So all those things motivated me to start the company, and they keep me very passionate about it every day.
So as you began to grow the company, when you look back on those days, maybe pick one of the things you wish you had done differently so that these younger entrepreneurs in the room can learn from your experience.
A lot. I mean, I made a lot of mistakes, but I also think I'll go through some of the mistakes, but one of the things that I did do right was to really focus on the partners that I had. Very early on, I took money from Kleiner Perkins. I'd been funding the company myself and through friends and family for about 2.5 years. And Kleiner offered me a deal that was for more equity and less money than other venture funds. But I took it because I knew that the way they operated and the network which they were involved in could be substantial and significant for my company. So if you pick the right partners and the right people around you, you can weather mistakes you otherwise wouldn't be able to weather. So one of the big mistakes that I made was I went into food service too quickly. And so the initial product I had, I was importing from Asia, and this was a great product. It wasn't great. It wasn't good enough to break through into the mainstream, but I was selling it to universities and hospitals and things like that up and down the East Coast. And I thought that was great. That model should work. I should basically expand that across the country. So I got some money in from investors, and I hired a big food service team. And I took people out of their jobs at places like Purdue and Tyson and other very large meat companies that come, you know, sell this new form of meat. It's plant-based meat. Sell it into hospitals and universities and other institutional buyers, and it didn't work. And I had to let each of them go. And it was a horrible experience for me. And so that's a mistake that I really, really regret. And so, understanding the sector that you're playing in, I thought I could buck all the trends. You know, people said you gotta go to retail first because you build your brand that way. But I thought the product was doing so well, I could skip that step. You can't, you know, you gotta go through your paces.
So another thing that we talked about with respect to building the team is setting a culture and a tone.
Yeah.
So, first of all, what culture and tone did you try to set at the very beginning of the company? And has it evolved given the exponential growth?
I hope that the core is still there, which is a difficult thing to maintain. But the culture is very clear at Beyond Meat. So, and we do it in the language we use to describe our facilities and our programs. So the research lab that we have in Los Angeles is called the Manhattan Beach Project. And we call it that because I wanted to evoke that sense of urgency and scale of what happened at the Chicago during the Second World War under those infamous bleachers. And the idea was, let's bring together the very best scientists, let's bring together the very best engineers and the best managers, let's fund them properly, and let's give them a goal that's worthy of urgency. And that goal is to not to tell people not to eat meat, that would be a big mistake, but let's figure out a way to continue to eat meat, but do it in a way that's decoupled from all of these issues I just raised. And that, in my view, is to build that piece of meat directly from plants. And so, just very briefly, the way we do that is instead of running plant material and water through an animal, which is the current way that people use to concentrate amino acids and nutrients in what we call meat. We're essentially pulling those directly from plants, and we're running them through a system of heating, cooling, and pressure, which is some of the most elemental forces that shape so much of what's around us. That creates, instead of, let's say, protein appearing like this in plants, we break it and have it reset into the form of muscle. That's it. So instead of using the animal's digestive tract and their muscular system to organize plant material, right? Remember, they're consuming a lot of plants and they're consuming a lot of water and they're using their biology to reset that into muscle. We're doing that by taking it direct from plants and running it through heating, cooling, and pressure. That's it. And so we do this in the Manhattan Beach Project. The program that we innovate under is called the Beyond Meat Rapid and Relentless Innovation Program. And so everything we do is around how do we get people to think and act more urgently, right? There's no water time, water cooler stuff at our company. Like, we work very hard. You have families, you should go home to them at night and be present with them. But when you're at work, you need to be intense. And even how you prepare for work is really important at our company. You know, we have a bunch of folks that do.
So when you say prepare for work,
what do you do when you get up in the morning? You know, are you filling your body with carbs and things that, you know, make you slower mentally and exhausted more easily physically? Or are you exercising? Are you getting the right foods in your body at the beginning of the day so you can stay clear and focused throughout the day? All those things are really important at the company. It allows us to be as competitive as we possibly can be.
And so as you talked about the process of creating plant-based protein.
Yep.
Some people would say, hey, Ethan, I can just eat a bowl of salad.
Yeah.
Versus your quote-unquote processed,
yeah.
quote-unquote meat.
Yeah.
Talk about that for us a little bit.
Thank you. No, that's a great question. It's one that's very topical. You know, one of the things that I lament about our current age is that, you know, you used to have like three papers and they had like real editors that told you what you can and cannot write. But today it's like anyone can write whatever they want, you know, and so we get all these articles that, you know, question whether we're processed and they make claims that are not right and all these other things, false claims. But here's what I think about process. So it's a tale of two processes. It's not, is our food processed and the food that you're currently eating not processed? So our process is to take those proteins and those lipids directly from plants, pull them through our system, and deliver them straight to your plate. The other process, industrial meat, I'm not talking about the, you know, organic hens you can get on Long Island or, you know, Marin County, but how most of us eat, right? That is a process that involves hormones and antibiotics, depending on the species, dioxin, arsenic, right? Veterinary drugs. There's a program at the USDA called the residue program. I don't know if anyone knows what that, does anyone know what that program is? It's designed to keep all the residue of all of the things I just mentioned out of the meat supply, and it does not work, right? So there is a process to meat, just like there's a process to our plant-based meat, and it's a question of which one do you want? And here's the offer I would make to you. You're more than willing to come anytime to our facilities in Missouri. You don't need an appointment. You can knock on the door, and I'll make sure you get a great tour and a great meal. But I want you to do that in the meat industry as well. I want you to go see their process, right? And so it's really important to think about the world in the way it actually is. There's a process for both types of meat that we consume, and which one do you feel comfortable? We're going to be doing a lot of marketing around that to come. The process we use is the same process that is used for pasta. We just do it differently.
So you had a focus on being a public company.
Yeah.
Maybe start with that, because some people in this room would probably maybe say they never want to be public. Yeah. Maybe they do. But yeah. What was your thought process around becoming a public company?
Yeah, so I set that as a goal in 2013. And I had a person who was working for one of our board members sort of pull me aside and said, you know, it's like your revenue's like $6 million. Like, you sound crazy. But, you know, I set it for 2013. I wanted to do it in 2017. And we missed it by, you know, 2 years. But I wanted to do that because I don't want to be a small meat company. I want to be a global meat company. I want to be a global protein company. You know, people asked, New York Times asked the other day, do you want to keep collaborating with some of the meat companies you collaborated in the past? I said, now past that, I want to be one of them. You know, I want to be Tyson. I want to be JBS in terms of size and impact on the world market. And I think going public was an important step toward that. You know, that national platform, the opportunity. You know, we're going to go, I wrote this the other day for our board, you know, this is a launching pad for us. That's it. It's a stepping stone that we finally have gotten to, but now is when we have to dig and go hardest. We have to go into Asia the hardest we possibly can. We have to go into Europe the hardest we possibly can. In the U.S., I mean, if you look at the announcements we made in the last quarter, we signed tests with McDonald's, Dunkin', KFC, Subway. Right? I mean, those Subway's the largest by location. McDonald's the largest by revenue. You know, you don't do that without intensity. And we have competitors that want to just absolutely yank that from our hands. We'll do anything possible to do that. And so now is the time to dig in and work harder rather than, you know, rest on our laurels.
Which also might be surprising to some people in the world, in the room. You talk about vegan, there's a certain maybe stereotype about that. There's been a number of world-class athletes.
Love it. Yeah.
That have proactively come to you.
Yeah.
Talk a little bit about that.
Oh, I love it. So I had my dream come true. I was actually in Sports Illustrated.
Let me just be clear. So what you really don't know about Ethan is before he started eating Beyond Meat, he was 5 feet.
I already was, yeah. It's been amazing
what's
happened.
There's hope for us all.
It's incredible. The problem is I'm just trying to slow it now. I'm about to become like 7 foot. But no, it's that is so gratifying to me. I'll tell the story about that super quick. So my dad is a professor, and he's a professor at McGill now. But when I was growing up, he's at the University of Maryland. And so I was, as a kid, you know, he hated being in the city. Like, he grew up in the country, married my mom. My mom was from the city. They tried to make it work in some way, but didn't anyway. But so he ended up spending a lot of time at our farm, and I would love him. My dad would go with him. So I spent my weekends, summertime, stuff like that, a lot of times banging around our farm, and he turned it into a dairy operation. We had 100 head of Holstein cattle. And so I learned a lot about the milk industry, and one of the things that made an impression on me was the Got Milk campaign itself, which many of you are of the age where you remember that, like Bo Jackson, you know, then Derek Jeter and everything else. And it just surprised me that a particular protein could advertise in children's schools, like in the lunch line, in the gym, with all these athletes. And so, you know, I remembered that, and I said, you know, when I start this company, that's what I'm going to do. And so I actually hired the architect of the Got Milk campaign, the original sponsor from the California Milk Board, a guy named Jeff Manning. And he's a great guy. He's in his 70s now. And I said, I want you to build this for this generation, the Go Beyond campaign, right? Future protein. And so we started to make overtures to players. I think the first one I signed was David Wright of the Mets, and then J.J. Redick. And then as things happen, as the truth of this product started to get out, in the sense that you don't need to ice so much because your joints aren't being inflamed. If there's one thing you remember from this entire talk, download and watch this movie called Game Changers. It's about plant-based athletes. It's sponsored by Chris Paul, or executive produced by Chris Paul, Arnold Schwarzenegger, and James Cameron. But anyway, so they started to learn about the benefits and how you feel light. One of my favorites is Victor Oladipo. He plays for the Pacers. He would say, I feel feathery after I eat this product. And so, you know, you're getting all the nutrients you need. And that's the thing about this I really want to impart. The animal's organizing protein and nutrients in a certain way, but that's all it's doing. Those things exist outside of the animal, and they're just being collected in the animal and delivered to us, right? We don't need to do that anymore. We can figure out ways to pull it directly from the plant kingdom and give it to you as meat. But so guys like Kyrie Irving started to invest, and then Chris Paul and DeAndre Hopkins, DeAndre Jordan, you know, JaVale McGee, Todd Gurley, all these guys started coming in, and I welcomed them and I love them because, you know, they're beautiful specimens, right? And they're incredible. I mean, their bodies are just, you know, there's not an ounce of fat. There's just everything they put in their body they're thinking about, right? One of the people we collaborate with a lot with now is LeBron James' trainer, right? And he's seeding it out to different players in the NBA. And my dream is to make the NBA completely vegan. I don't know if that's going to happen. But
you're on your way.
I'm on my way. And I feel the kids respond to that. I got a lot of pressure from marketers early on that I had to go on to, you know, I did it, Dr. Oz and all this stuff, and talk about, you know, the clinical, you know, nutritionist type pitch. And I wanted to inspire people. But that's the way to sell a product. It's not to build a brand, it's to build a movement. And you can build a movement when you sell something that you're passionate about and people can feel that, and then they start to improve their lives. Or if you have a colleague who's working with us right now.
Yeah.
He's 10 days he's been consuming our products and going plant-based. He's lost 12 pounds. I mean, it's just a great feeling to help people.
So the other piece of the Four Horsemen that you touched on, but I'd love for you just to give some stats around how much energy, water, land takes to, you know where I'm headed.
Yeah, she's heard my road pitch like 400 times. Like, why don't you tell
them? I love it.
Okay.
I'd never do it justice.
No. So we had there's a lot of hand waving in this field, so you got to be careful. And so we wanted to trade in facts, not in hyperbole and stuff. And so we did an analysis with the University of Michigan around the life cycle environmental impact of our products. And they compared it to our burger to ground beef. And the results were startling. I mean, they were stunning. We used 99% less water. So think about that for a minute. So I was walking down my street the other day, not the other day now, it was during the California drought, like a couple years ago, the significant drought. And I went to a restaurant with my family, and there were no water glasses on the table, and they said, you have to ask for water. I thought, okay, great, I'll ask for water. But you open up the menu, it was like all steak and like burgers. And so it's just like, you gotta think these things through. But anyway, so we use 99% less water than conventional meat. We use 93% less land. I'll return to that in a second. We use half the energy, and we have 90% fewer emissions. So think about that land for a second. So 93% less land. So the digital economy did amazing things for us in this room and for people who live in the Boston Tech Corridor, Silicon Valley, the Washington DC Tech Corridor, et cetera. But rural America was left out. And I spent a lot of time there. I started the company in Appalachia, actually. There's a big opiate crisis there, as you guys know. People can't find jobs. The youth are leaving and going either to non-productive work or into the city. And here's an opportunity to bring innovation back to agriculture. So if I have 100 acres and I'm planting that currently in corn, soy, or wheat to feed cows or to feed pigs or to feed chicken, right? I'm gonna make a certain amount of money, but it's a commodity. If I plant now just 7 acres in protein crops directly for human consumption, I can generate the same number of burgers, right? So if I use all 100 to grow animal feed and feed it to an animal, that's one way to do it. Or I can just use 7 and I'll generate at the end of the day, the same number of burgers. So I've now given that farmer 93 other acres to work with to grow things for their family. So we're gonna be out there telling that story, working with farmers to help them convert land into higher use economically for them. And I think that'll make a big difference in how we're being received by so much of the agricultural community.
All right, so just before we wrap up, if folks in this audience were interested in learning more about vegan, is there a certain book that right. you happen to like?
Yeah. I hate to say this, I hope that all your kids read and stuff, but if they don't, the Game Changers movie is amazing. It's funny, this stuff has been around forever. Diet for a Small Planet was written in 1971, and that makes the basic case that I just made in many ways. But the movie is the one that would really get people to watch. It'll change how you think about what you put in your body.
All right.
Yeah.
Thank you, Ethan.
Yep, thank you very much. Thank you so much.